Parachutes have come a long way. If we go back about 100 years, this is what they would have looked like, possibly followed by a visit to the chiropractor. The development of modern parachutes and how personnel were trained, the variety of applications that they have and the nations that pioneered them, and why, after more than 70 years, American troops are moving away from round parachutes to this other style, and not this one, is not what you think. The word parachute was coined by the French inventor Louis-Sébastien Lenormand, who also constructed his own parachute and successfully jumped from the Tower of Parisian Observatory in 1783. About 300 years prior to that, Da Vinci took a break from painting the Mona Lisa and designed a conical parachute. But the concept of parachute goes way back to over 2,000 years ago, as documented by Chinese historians. But the utility of parachutes became more obvious once humans could fly. Pilots can now survive burning airplanes, cargo can be quickly delivered to remote areas, and astronauts can safely come back to Earth, all thanks to parachutes. Now, contrary to popular belief, you actually don't need a parachute to go skydiving, but you do need one if you want to go twice. Even as late as World War I, most American pilots did not wear parachutes, and the use of parachutes was mostly limited to stuntmen. In contrast, France and Germany were some of the earliest adopters of parachutes for their military pilots. Wearing parachutes for US Army aviators only became compulsory post-World War I in 1921. In the early 1930s, Russia started experimenting with parachutes for other military use. Russia led the way in the use of jump towers in the training of paratroopers. These towers were used with specially constructed parachutes for the training. Successful large-scale assaults from the sky were first carried out by Germany. The invasion of Netherlands in 1940 and the Battle of Crete in 1941 saw some of the earliest mass paratroop drops to occupy tactical points and assist the advance of ground troops. Following in the footsteps of Russians, Americans also built training towers at Fort Benning, Georgia. The towers were 250 feet high. The training was made up of Ground Week, Tower Week, and Jump Week. During Ground Week, trainees would simulate jumping off the airplane by jumping off a platform. This was followed by other exercises to get used to the feeling of the parachute opening, and in some cases, ouch. Tower Week was when the trainees would get some height for the first time. It would start by getting pulled up and released in a controlled manner to get used to the parachutes. The next training was to get them accustomed to the jerk when the parachute opens. Then practicing how to land, which is probably one of the most important parts, as we'll discuss later. And the final step was a descent on their own. Jump Week was when it would all come together, as trainees would get into airplanes, get up in the sky, and jump out for their graduation. 80 years later, and much of the training is still done in a similar fashion for Ground Week, Tower Week, and Jump Week. The T5 parachute was standardized in June of 1941 and was heavily employed in all theaters of action. The Americans were the only airborne troops in World War II to use a reserve parachute. It rested below their chest toward their stomach and could be deployed in case the main chute malfunctioned. Easily identified with its round canopy, the T5 underwent numerous upgrades throughout the years, all the way to T10D. A study of more than 131,000 jumps showed that on average, every 1,000 jumps resulted in 8.4 injuries. But 88% of those injuries were associated with ground impact. And this is why, in recent years, the US military started replacing the T-10s with T-11 parachutes, which for the first time do not have a round canopy. The main canopy on the T-11s is a modified version of a cross or cruciform platform. The new canopy has increased inflated diameter and increased surface area when compared with the T-10D. The T11 is designed to have an average rate of descent of 19 feet per second, compared with 24 feet per second with the T10C. This reduction in the rate of descent is intended to result in significantly lower landing injury rates for the jumpers. The unique design characteristics of cruciform parachutes also reduce oscillations and swinging back and forth during descent. You may find it interesting that T11 and its predecessors are not really maneuverable. Some versions of them allow you to turn, but that's about it. But there are good reasons for this. Just imagine the sky filled with hundreds of paratroopers steering all over the place. Lack of maneuverability also helps keep the forces together when deploying substantial number of paratroopers. The job of these parachutes is to get you down on the ground quickly and safely, and that's about it. Ram Air parachutes are typically rectangular. The canopy is divided into a set of individual cells. When air enters or rams into the front of the canopy, it inflates the cells and gives the parachute an airfoil shape, which not only is quite maneuverable, it can also make landing a lot easier. With non-maneuverable parachutes, which are incapable of generating lift, it is crucial to use the parachute landing fall or PLF technique in order to land safely and without injury. The US military does employ ram air parachutes as well, but they are primarily used by special operations forces and special mission units, not conventional forces. Today, just about everyone who uses parachutes for sports or recreational purposes use ram air canopies. But the utility of parachutes goes well beyond that. The Russian experiments with parachutes in the 1930s were not limited to pilots or other military personnel. They were developing parachutes that could deliver vehicles and weapons. The Russians developed an early method for cargo drop, where the chute was deployed first, which is essentially how cargo is airdropped these days. They even tried low-altitude drops without parachutes. Not sure what those guys were doing in there, but they sure look happy. This technique evolved into low-altitude parachute extraction system, or LAPES, even though it's not common anymore. With the development of cargo airplane, transporting large amounts of cargo became possible. Korea came up with advanced ways of airdropping massive crates of cargo, from munition to large military vehicles. Huge nylon chutes were used, which could handle airdrop of artillery and light armor. The ability to deliver large amounts of cargo over long distances revolutionized the concept of military supply and cannot be underestimated. Other uses of parachutes during World War II included planting mines in shipping lanes from the air. The parachutes were used to slow down the descent of the mines so they would not detonate on impact. Before the invention of ejection seats, the only way of escaping from an incapacitated aircraft was to bail out. But in many scenarios, this could prove difficult due to the pilot being injured, the impact of high G-forces, or simply getting out of the confined space of the cockpit in a timely manner. So ejection seats were invented. Although, as aircraft speed increased, especially into the supersonic range, the ejection systems had to evolve. Encapsulated seat egress systems were developed for use in the B-58 Hustler and B-70 Valkyrie supersonic bombers. These seats were enclosed in an air-operated clamshell, which permitted the aircrew to escape at airspeeds and altitude high enough to otherwise cause bodily harm. These seats were designed in a way to allow the pilot to control the plane even with the clamshell closed, and the capsule would float in the case of a water landing. Whether it's used for aircraft deceleration, return of crew members from space missions, or just a routine parachute jump, the parachute riggers play a critical role in the safety of those involved. In the US Armed Forces, the riggers wear red hats. It may look casual, but parachute riggers are authorized to wear these distinctive red baseball caps as their military headgear when on rigger duties. The riggers frequently make parachute jumps themselves. Not only does this help them to better understand how the equipment that they prepare and maintain works, it's kind of a quality check too. Because if you're not willing to jump with a parachute that you or your colleagues have packed, maybe others shouldn't either.